Q&A function that's at the bottom of your Zoom window. So just as you think of a question, go ahead and ask it, and then we'll field it after the presentation. And if you're viewing us by live stream on YouTube, you can use the live stream chat function in YouTube. And our moderators will relay these questions to me. And then many thanks to Joe at Live Stream Success for helping us in this presentation. And of course, to our staff who are handling the technical details, including Liz Grumbach, the Assistant Director, Lauren Whippy, Communication Specialist Senior, and Selena Asuna, the IHR Coordinator and Assistant Director of Desert Humanities. I'm Ron Broglio, the Associate Director of the Institute for Humanities Research, and thank you for spending part of your evening with us. We're here to honor Juan for her book, The Shenzhen Experiment, The Story of China's Instant City. It was chosen, a bit of background, the book award is chosen, this book was chosen, by the Institute for Humanities Research Faculty Board. It's chosen from over 50 books submitted by over 45 publishers. So, and again, thanks to our co-sponsors, the Herberger School of Architecture and Design and the Center for Philosophical Technologies. So Juan Du is Associate Professor at the Department of Architecture at the University of Hong Kong, where she is Associate Dean of International and Mainland China Affairs and the Director of the Urban Ecologies Design Lab. She holds a Doctorate of Science in Architecture from Swiss Federal Institute of Technology, the ETH in Zurich, a degree of Master's in Architecture from Princeton University, and is the recipient of a U.S. Fulbright Scholarship for her research on the transformation of contemporary Chinese cities. Juan Du has previously taught architectural and urban design at MIT and the Graduate Center of Architecture at Peking University. Juan Du's research and writings have been published in Asia, Europe, and the United States, including the Architectural Review, Volume, Domus, the Journal of Architectural Education, E-Flux, one of my favorites, Time in Architecture, Urban Flux, and Urban China. Juan is a recognized scholar on China's rapid urbanization, and her work has been featured in international journals and media, including the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, Financial Times, Foreign Affairs, CNN, Wired, and Nature. Harvard University Press, when she approached Harvard about this book, it was interesting, and we had this conversation during a coffee chat earlier this week, that Harvard wanted her to do something that was broader than the singular focused discipline of architecture and the depth of complexity of the issues in architecture. So she had to translate those complexities for a broader audience while not losing some of the rigor and insights. And it's for that ability to make those kinds of moves that are both broadly interdisciplinary as well as maintaining certain rigors that we really want to recognize Juan Du for this. Some of the Institute board members, committee members, have highlighted key elements of this book for recognition. And I'll quote from these briefly. Quote, the author taps into the environmental, geographic, architectural, cultural, history, politics, of people, time, and place to tell a story of this unique Chinese experiment. And Juan Du has brought environmental studies, urban studies, ethnic studies, and the power of narrative nonfiction to bear on illuminating stories about the politics and possibilities of massive, massive social transformation. And throughout, her storytelling is evident, and it's a real lure to understanding the larger architectural landscapes and the many storied peoples that that involves. In general, these stories point to ways of dwelling, and ways of dwelling follow on to ways of building as architectural forms. So what we're noticing here in her work is a relationship between cultures, histories, and ideologies, and their deep and rich layers. So thank you for joining us, and I'll now turn this over to Juan Du.
Thank you so much, Ron. Thank you for that introduction. I have to say I was so pleasantly surprised to have received this award from the Institute of Humanities Research, and I'm very, very honored. I did notice that the Institute has a long history of giving these book awards, and I'm really read some of the books of the past authors, and really truly honored to be joining this community. I also thought many of the books that were submitted this year was very good, and it's truly has been very helpful for me to be able to. To be able to finally accept that, you know, a lot of the extra time, years, in fact, to try to reframe this, the research on the book, so that it could be accessible to a broader intellectual audience, which, as you mentioned, was Harvard Press, specifically the formidable Sharmila Sen. It was her mandate from the first meeting we met, is to make sure that this book is intellectual, but not entirely only to a specific audience. So the other thing I would like to share about, Ron, when you were speaking about the narratives and stories issue, is that there was a second suggestion from Sharmilison that I didn't follow. The second suggestion was that in order to connect to the readers on this very, very complex history, she recommended I write the book in the first person to be able to give a human character to this very complex set of, as you said, cultures, histories, and ideologies. I just couldn't bring myself to to write entire book from the first person. I felt that I was not comfortable to do this. So what I struggled, the result of my struggle at the end was that rather than writing it from my own personal narrative, the last 2 years of finishing the manuscript for the book was about how to integrate, and in fact how to let narratives of people in Shenzhen, from common migrant all the way to mayors, politicians, villagers, how to let their story and their narratives and their relationship with this very remarkable city be the human connection between the readers, which I've come to understand that many have never been to Shenzhen, many have never been to China. So I think this was the way that I was able to kind of meet those broad mandates. So I would try to give a talk on the book. I had to say that even though the book came out in February, it took receiving this great award for me to to come to realize I must accept that the first book talk I give post-publication would be online, because the book came out in February and we were in Hong Kong, we're already in the middle of a pandemic, and then slowly the world. So I'm very honored and a little bit nervous about trying to connect with all of you at the Institute, also at Arizona State University. I know there are also some colleagues and students and friends listening from my part of the world. It's very early. Thank you very much for being with us. So I will go ahead and share some of my thoughts on how the book is organized and why I organized it that way, and hopefully to give some layer behind the story behind the story, so to speak, of the writing and in the end wrapping up and producing the book. So the cover image of the book, I was told, was quite surprising to some of the people who first saw the book. The cover image was taken by a wonderful photographer in Shenzhen, who was trained as an architect and now works full-time as a photographer. And it's an aerial photo he took of Baishizhou Urban Village. So for those of you who have already read parts of my book, you'll know that Baishizhou is how actually I start the introduction of the book, and also how I end the book. It's the last chapter of the book. So a little bit insider story, director's comments. And the reason why that was a bit a surprise to many people, that that was the image that I would recommend to the university press, and that they also chosen, is that this is the typical image that most people have of Shenzhen. If you were to Google online Shenzhen and look at the majority of the publications, or I should say the majority of the media's kind of reporting of Shenzhen, this is what you would see. So the book is very much about trying to say, well, behind this this image of an instant modern city, there's also another layer, and then there's also another time, which is why the image chosen for the inside cover was this one. And this is a 17th century portrayal of exactly the same area that we're in this part of the world, in Shenzhen, Hong Kong. And you'll see that this these four cities, in fact, have been here for centuries, and in some cases over a millennium. And you know, these images, while they are part of the book, I have to say, because I'm trained as an architect, the imageries and the forms and the shapes of both the city itself and representations of the city, representations of the region, were very much sources for me to be able to think about the region, to think about Shenzhen, and to be able to synthesize everything together in somewhat a coherent book, I hope. The book is organized in four parts, and I did my best to try to give a bit of a structure. And you know, as I mentioned, I've spent probably the last 2-3 years of working on the book, essentially trying to reframe the content of the book to a broader intellectual audience. So what I would like to share is the book is almost written, not purposely, but in terms of how it became backwards, that I wrote these chapters 5, 6, 7, 8. In fact, 6, 7, 8, those were the earliest content. And then chapters 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, the content for those probably came sequentially in that order. So the narrative became bigger and bigger. And that's because that when I first started having this idea to want to write a book on Shenzhen, and this was over 15 years ago, It was that I was really moved and compelled by the urban villages of the city, and I really wanted to find out more, and I really wanted to share that with everyone, everyone in Shenzhen, everyone in China, in Asia, and the world, just because I found it to be such a remarkable side of the city that wasn't very much discussed, especially 15, 20 years ago. Then through the research and on the book, through speaking to different villagers, through speaking with migrants, through further whether literature review or spatial analysis, I realized actually the story or the history of the urban villages is the history of Shenzhen, but it is the history of Shenzhen in a much broader sense that went far beyond its 40 years. And then there was a realization, the history of Shenzhen over the past 40 years very much reflects the history of China over the past 40 years. And it coincides not completely accidentally with China's reform and opening, kind of this drastic change that China has gone through in the past 40 years. So then the book is the organization of the book tried to reflect that really the why Shenzhen's history is important is that there is a national relevance to that. There is also a very deep rooted connection of Shenzhen with the broader region, being at the tip of the South China Sea, its relationship to Hong Kong, the entire Pearl River Delta. So that broadly we're scaling down for the national relevance to the regional history. And then of course the city itself, the city construction, of looking at at the urban scale, how the city became to be materialized through infrastructure and buildings and housing. And then the last one, we zoom in even further in scale to understand two very specific neighborhoods. And in this case, it's the two urban villages I've chosen, one in the middle of the city and one another district, but inside another one of the most well-developed and expensive residential and technology areas of the city. So in order to bring then all of this into a connection, I mentioned that I was reluctant to use a first person to write these content. I was fortunate to have been able to meet and interview and also learn about through literature and archives and previous publications these wonderful cast of characters, but they're actually real people. And this first chapter was framed around this particular song. And the person that wrote the song, the composer Jiang Kairu, was wonderful, wonderful thinker. And he really, I feel like his story really was far more interesting than my own in being able to frame the relationship, this very, very unexpected and intimate and monumental relationships of individuals with an entire city. And I want to share a little bit, just a little clip of that song, just because the information, as I said, that the information through a book is through the written form. But as this award is in recognition for interdisciplinary humanities research, I wanted to show a little bit extreme sources of the knowledge that I drew from. And this is a particular music video. It was one of China's first music videos and of the song, The Story of Spring. So let's see if this works. I 中国的梦海的花都已落了雪 this is what's difficult about an online talk. I don't know if everyone's totally confused. I'm absolutely thrilled. I'm just going to assume you just find it totally fascinating. The reason why I wanted to show you this clip is that this particular music video, as I said, it was at the very beginning of China's reform, and it was when media and cultures that hasn't been around in China, such as music videos, started to appear in China. And this particular song, a lot of the scenes that you saw during the first part of this clip were the singer Dong Wenhua walking through Shenzhen in the 1980s. In the late 1980s. And you were seeing those were not historical footages, right? This is a historical document, so to speak. You were seeing the city being built as she was speaking about it. I know that the song and the subtitle is in English, but the book is in Chinese, but the book does have the English translation of the lyrics. And the other reason why I ended the frame on this one is that we previously saw images of the Great Wall. We saw images. Now this is the Forbidden City in Beijing. So just to be able to make evidence, and also for me to be able to really understand and analyze the fact that Shenzhen, via this cultural production of the song, was very much important in the cultural aspects of the opening up of China and this optimism of this can-do spirit and anything is possible. That type of humanistic drive, that type of individualism, and that type of energy is very much how I have felt, have come to conclude after over nearly 20 years of both researching but also working in the city of Shenzhen, is that human spirit is the most overlooked aspect of the success behind Shenzhen, and I would say also behind China over the past 40 years. So we might come back to that in a bit later. So the song, the songwriter Jiang Kairu and the song itself allows me also his personal story to be able to introduce the very complex and interesting and fascinating history between Shenzhen and Hong Kong. I did not single Hong Kong out in a particular chapter, meaning the relationship between Shenzhen and Hong Kong, but Hong Kong does appear in the book. We did a word count when one of the early blind reviewers said, why is Hong Kong not acknowledged? We did a word count that the Hong Kong appears over 200 times in the book, and in some chapters over 50. So what I have come to understand is that the history of Shenzhen, the history of Hong Kong, is really interlinked in such a deep, broadly, cultural aspects that goes far beyond even national politics. Chapter two is using chapter one, the device was a cultural production of a song. Chapter two, we could say, was a political campaign of the Southern Tourist by Deng Xiaoping himself. But what I want to do with the utilizing this narrative of Deng Xiaoping's visits to Shenzhen, I wanted to be able to bring out this kind of complex early planning process of the city. And that because there was such a political emphasis on the need for Shenzhen to be the poster child of the success of a new policy, the success of a new China, the success of modernity and capital, that a lot of the much more valuable and nuanced history of how kind of the earliest stage of planning the city and building the city, especially during that first decade, I think got broadly overlooked, and you might perspective still being overlooked. So being able to use something that everyone immediately associated with Shenzhen, Deng Xiaoping himself, his southern tour, to be able then to draw out this other kind of background story to demonstrate that a lot of the so-called kind of the embedded intelligence of Shenzhen's urbanization was not to particular individuals, it was to groups of people, communities, and kind of this larger historical geography of the region, which then lead to the second part of regional history, where I wanted to really cite this part was really about citing Shenzhen in a particular place. And that place is a very historical one, it's a very rich one, it's a very environmental story I wanted to tell, and a cultural one. So chapter three uses the device would be a gateway city, historic fort, in this case, Nantou. Historic fort, to be able to contextualize and bring out this larger regional history, that the fact that all, not only the fort, but many of the small dots you see, these are all historic villages of Shenzhen and Hong Kong, and these have existed for centuries. This is a survey map by Italian missionary that lived in Hong Kong, but had followers and communities and collaborators all over the region. Chapter four's device, I would say, is oyster. The reason why I chose the oyster is I wanted to speak about the drastic and massive environmental change of the Pearl River Delta. You know, and oysters being one of the most sensitive organisms to pollution, especially water pollution, and even salinity, the change of sea levels, sea level rise, floodplain changes. So, you know, and really utilize the fact that oysters cultivation have existed in this region for a millennium, and it was really famous and well known for having oysters, having the best oysters in China. But due to the parallel impact of rapid urbanization, this is a NASA image of Shenzhen, the Pearl River Delta in 1988. And we see 15 years later, all of the farming fields and kind of wetlands were nearly entirely covered up. And this has further contributed to the sedimentation, the change in water quality, the change in salinity, and really completely changed the ecology of the region. And I really wanted to be able to also contextualize what has happened in Shenzhen within the Greater Pearl River Delta. And I wanted to be able to contextualize that further in from an environmental perspective without, with it still, hopefully still seemingly a natural part of the book. And then we get on to the few sections that de facto what was the majority of what I thought originally would be the entire book. So city construction, I wanted really to show how Shenzhen, now we're coming to relatively modern history, really transformed from the 50s till today. So every chapter, for those who read some parts of the book, every chapter jumps a little bit around in time. It's not absolutely chronological, but I do try to span the history prior to 1979, prior to China's reform, prior to the establishment of the city of Shenzhen, to after 1979, and try to really show through evidence that the history that existed prior to the 1970s absolutely left impacts and on how the city was urbanized and transformed and developed, and I know we're arguing still do so today. And I try to do that by giving this understanding of the high rise. So Shenzhen was the first city in China to have clusters of tall buildings and high rises. And this is somewhat relatively known, at least within my professional and academic community. But what is not known is really how difficult those buildings were built, both from the way it was financed to the way it was constructed, and how many barriers and walls and new ways of innovation, both financial systems, but also political systems and also labor systems and, of course, architectural systems, in order to give us this lineage, this history of Shenzhen constantly having, you know, the tallest tower, the fastest built, the tallest tower in China, and then the tallest tower in Shenzhen, and this particular thrive and history for the high rise in Shenzhen really. Its impacted really beyond architecture. It was very much the high rise became a symbol for modernization and urbanization in China, and that's very much because it became such part of the psyche of everyone in China that Shenzhen was synonymous with high rise and that if any city in China wanted to demonstrate they also have urbanized and modernized and are economically successful, they should have a tower. So it's a, you know, on that, it's a very much a double-edged sword. Chapter 6 tries to tell a deeper story behind one of the towers by first telling the story of the Now House and the Now House's owners. And the Now House is, for those who's not familiar with this term, is in China when very often urban renewal and urban redevelopment happens, we demolish huge sectors and neighborhoods, and when a particular owner doesn't agree and kind of hold out, it's been called an outhouse. And this entire chapter is really framed around these two persons you see standing in the front, especially through the woman, Zhang Lianhao, a villager, through her perspective. Because I also noticed in much of the histories and stories and narratives coming out of China's urbanization, it's been dominated by, obviously, history of a male perspective. And this was really important for me to be able to tell a story from her perspective. And Huduzi, who's read this chapter, it's not a happy tale for her. But I want to be able to show that there is a human cost behind these shiny images of the new city that we see, and that very often, just like we have witnessed in other cities, whether it's New York or London or Paris, that very often in the drive for urban development, especially urban redevelopment, there are many lives that were impacted. And very often those lives were the people who contributed to the early success of the city in the first place. Finally, the last part of district transformation focuses on two particular urban villages located in particularly important locations. In this case, this is Huanggang Village, located right in the middle of the CBD, the political center of Shenzhen. And just to kind of use the story of this particular village that have existed in this location for a documented history of 700 years. And this particular village really went from really transformed so dramatically, not only in the past 40 years, but also throughout its previous history. If you're interested, please look further into this chapter. But just to be able to share and utilize the villages, this particular village's history, to present the story that while the cities, in this case Shenzhen, while we mainly concentrate look at the high rises and the large buildings and the roads and such, there's a lot of hidden and informal housing settlements and housing networks that really supports our cities, and in this case supporting Shenzhen. From the first day one of the establishment of Shenzhen in 1979 and still till today. And the last chapter is by Shizhou, is in fact the first urban village neighborhood I experienced myself in 2005. So I ended the book on really my first experience with this really deep history and complex cultural phenomenon of the fact that you have large neighborhoods of what they're self-built in a sense. So this man smoking, leisurely smoking cigarette, was one of the first villagers I interviewed. He owns this particular building, and when he first moved to this particular village in the 50s, when his village was being flooded to build a Shenzhen reservoir, he lived in one of these row houses you see in the middle of the image. And then when Shenzhen urbanized, each of the villagers was able to build one house. And so that balcony, I believe is this one. So he and his brother owns this particular building. Oh, you may not be able to see my cursor. So that balcony is the white and pink outlined tile building in the background on the left, right next to this skinny tower that you see. This particular urban village is in the process of being cleared out as we speak. I finished this particular chapter probably 4 or 5 years ago already, and since that time, Shenzhen obviously have changed rapidly, and this particular neighborhood has changed rapidly. So I'm very sad to say that its ability to serve as a neighborhood park for many of the migrant children who live in the area is going to be no longer. Then we had to circle back to say that one of the reasons that really drove me to continue working on the book throughout the past 15 years is to be able to communicate how important the urban villages are to the city, culturally, economically, financially, and historically, because with the urban village demolishing, a lot of the centuries and old history of Shenzhen also will get demolished, at least physically. And most importantly, with the demolition of each urban village, also is the demolition of an arrival point for, in this case of Shenzhen, millions of migrant workers who has arrived in the city over the past 40 years to be able to find a cheap room, either for a few weeks or a few years, and to really to be able then to establish a foothold in the city, and then to go through to participate in the process of the city and to gain opportunities and to gain whether it's job or whether it's education that allows them to fulfill their own personal destiny. So in closing, I don't think I either, as I'm speaking with you today or as it's presented in the book, I don't think I'm saying that the urban villages or these kind of informal housing settlements and networks is the only aspect of Shenzhen. I also recognize and give credit, hopefully, and have given also the formal planning and formal construction and design. You know, as you see on the upper portion, that kind of these beautiful urban parks, innovative high rises. But what I hopefully what I've been able to do is to present through artifacts, through personal narratives, and through a few centuries of history, to present that our cities are complex. Our cities does not exist based on either the formal or the informal. It very much is two sides of the same coin, and they work with each other, and it's a relationship that ever shifts. But if we have a city that only have what you see in the upper portion of the city, that means the city will no longer be, will no longer have the vitalities it have, because you need for a city, for a nation, for any organization to continue to innovate, to continue to be vibrant culturally or economically, we need to be able for newcomers, for migrants, for new arrivals, whether it's from other cities or other countries, to be able to contribute to this place. And in fact, I would say that this long, rich, messy, hopefully interesting history that I've tried to portray in the book is, in fact, also a history of migration. It is to show how this particular city, this particular city in 1979 has 300,000 people. Today it has 20 million. So Shenzhen truly is a city of migrants, all the way from the construction workers to the mayors. So which is why in the end, I've decided to dedicate this book to Shenzhen's past and future migrants in pursuit of lives worth living. Again, this goes back to that kind of optimistic drive of individual pursuit and individual choices, and being able to make a choice to go to a place where you can make a better life for yourself and your families. And incidentally, you'll see I put also "and to my parents." That, of course, is for obvious reasons. Without them, I wouldn't be speaking with you. But also the fact that my parents were migrants from China to the United States in the 80s. So I was a very reluctant 10-year-old to move from China to the U.S. And having grown up in the U.S., I'm very much a child, an adult that is very much affected by my kind of migrant experiences. In addition to growing up in the U.S., I also worked in Europe for a number of years, in China, and now I've been working in Hong Kong for over 10 years. And in these personal experiences, and through my research, I've really come to believe that inclusion and openness of any organization, whether it's a school or a city or a country, really should be valued and cherished and encouraged and be thankful for rather than thinking that migrants are the problems. I very much believe, as we have seen in this history of Shenzhen, that migration, in fact, it drives the city. It drives the city to innovate beyond any singular plan or any singular politician's initial ideas. In the end, I hoped that in sharing the story, that this aspect might be able to communicate across cultural divides, across national borders, and be understood as something that is universal, and that connects all of us as human beings. So I'll end on that. I'll end the share on that.
Great, thank you so much. That was really just, it was lovely to have a bit of a tour of your thinking about the city and the city as a series of different thoughts and narratives. So really a nice preview. And I want to remind everyone who's watching that Arizona State University Library has digital copies of the book. So I would recommend if you get interested in particular chapters and aspects. It's incredibly readable. The style is just really accessible to a variety of disciplines and interests. We try to end on time, so we have maybe about 5 minutes or so for a question. And so start with this one from an audience member. Since you use the term experiment, can you comment on where Shenzhen is in the experimental process, and whether it is a success or even how you might define that?
Yeah. I opened the frame work of Shenzhen being an experiment, because that was the word used that during, I suppose, during the first decade. That was very much the attitude from, say, central government looking at Shenzhen to say, you know, let's see if this works. If it doesn't, we'll close it down. So it was very much this idea is like, could we have a city that has a relatively open market system? And that can experiment with different policies, whether they pertain to city planning, to housing, to labor contracts, to finance, and still work within kind of the broad national directions. So that was very much, in some ways, it's borrowing from that sentiment. At the chapter, the conclusion of the book, I come back to this term, and I basically have said that it's not only an experiment, it's a critical experiment, because it was experimenting with everything that this is in the 1980s and 90s of China. Shenzhen was experimenting with everything that the rest of the country was not. So it was, in fact, trying to chart a new path, a different path from which the country has been going towards. So that's how, this is why in the end I've decided for the book title to be the Shenzhen Experiment, is to call out upon the fact. The second reason gets back to, I love the question about the process, like where I think everyone believes that the Shenzhen experiment is a success and we're at the end of it, because they've been able to prove that I mentioned kind of this population rise from 300,000 to 20 million. In the book, I have also statistics to show in terms of GDP growth is astronomical. In human history as well, not only in China's history. So I think everyone assumes that it's been an economic success. For me, I'm more interested in it as the experiment as a city, the experiment as a migrant city, the experiment as a civic city, and a city that's quite different from the country that's hosting it. And I think one of my last paragraphs in the book is, I said that I believe the Shenzhen experiment is far from over, and that what has happened, especially in the past 40 years, it's so massive, so unprecedented in almost every aspect, not only for China, but for the world history of cities, that I think we're just starting to kind of, I'm just starting to kind of connect the dots a bit. And because what has happened is so monumentally different and in a different age, that I believe that we won't know whether it's success or not. And if it's success, what are the most fundamental ways that it's a success, until perhaps years later, perhaps centuries later. But for me, is I want to say that for me, that if anything, I hope the book helps to present my perspective that a city cannot have economic success without cultural success as well.
No, this is good. And it follows on a question that the Center for Philosophical Technologies is asking, which is, your book seems to be indirectly in conversation with Kelly Easterling's extra statecraft, but where she tells a story about the special economic zones, et cetera, on a global scale, and from the perspective of infrastructure, you do a marvelous job of telling a related story about Shenzhen in particular, but giving voice to the human cost of the special economic zone and so on. So can you tell us a little about the different frames on this same phenomena?
Yeah. Well, obviously, Kelly Easterling's book is, she has written about zones exception for many years prior to it consolidating into a book. I'm guessing the question is about that, even though we're both speaking about special economic zones, that I chose to frame it in a different way. Is that right? Wrong? Yeah. Maybe help me to further define.
Yeah, exactly. It's like the contrast is, how are you in conversation? How is your book different, doing something different? Yeah.
Yeah. So partly because I very naively accepted to write a book about the special economic zone in a way that could be accessible beyond my own discipline of architecture and, of course, associate disciplines of urban planning, urban economics, and such, and also urban theory. I've been teaching urban theory for 20 years, and it was very difficult for me to refrain from peppering, whether it's Keller Easling or many of the others throughout the book. I did cite her book, obviously, in different parts in the book. So, I would answer this question to say that if you look at the notes section of my book, there are architectural texts, there are theoretical texts, there are journal articles from data scientists about environmental changes in the Pearl River Delta. So the way I tried to bring this knowledge is, I would say, perhaps we can see the book as two different layers, that if you were to read the book completely ignoring the notes, hopefully you wouldn't feel like every page I'm coming across 10 words or 10 people, I have no idea who they are. But if you were to read the chapters in conjunction with the cited works, and if you're a graduate student, a researcher, I very much invite you and encourage you to do that. Then I think you will get a different, as sort of that secondary layer of reading of the book. I think in the end, unfortunately, because I had to cut the text in the end to fit into the, it's already a big book. In the end, I was given a choice to cut 30,000 words or cut the bibliography section. It was very painful. It was a very painful decision. So we decided to cut the bibliography section because all of the literatures and authors and thinkers and theories I've cited is also in the notes. as endnotes section. So we cut the bibliography section. But if you're to look at the endnotes, you will see when and how I try to still make connections, whether it's intellectual, theoretical, whether it's in provocation or in support with this kind of network of thinkers and theories that I frankly I'm much more familiar with than oyster cultivation, which I had to spend 6 months researching into that and exactly how that process goes. So I would say, you know, the process of especially the second half of working on the book, it's a very, very it was a process that was very challenging, but also really rewarding because it brought me to be able to study and analyze things that was far beyond architecture and urbanism.
Right. No, that's the beauty of this, is the complexity of the many other narratives. And just real quickly, and for those watching, just a final question. Thank everyone who is able to stay just for this. Is I'm curious just about your next steps from here. Are you interested in looking at other cities and drawing parallels?
It's interesting you would ask that question. So as I said, the manuscript for the book was really finished 3-4 years ago, and that's how long it takes for all the final touches into production. So I have been in Hong Kong for 15 years, and for the first decade, really for the first 10 years, many of my, whether professional work or academic and research, dealt working with communities in Shenzhen. And in the last 5 years, I really started to work with specific communities in Hong Kong. So what I've been working on the past 4 or 5 years is with a particular type of informal housing in Hong Kong called subdivided units. And very similar to the urban villages, it is the primary source for new migrants into Hong Kong. It's a primary source for anyone who doesn't qualify for public housing or is on the 5 to 10 year waiting list for public housing. So for me, my project on the city very much continues, and it's the same project, and it was the same. It is for the same reasons that I'm researching and writing and working with NGOs, working with community organizations, and working with the residents in Hong Kong who live in these particular informal housing types. It's for the same reason I'm working with them than when I first started to be interested in Shenzhen. So this thesis, if you will, that I have, that we can learn, in some ways we can learn so much from looking at these usually overlooked, whether it's housing or you could look at it as a social community, or you can look at a particular urban neighborhoods, we can learn so much more from examining these particular groups and learn from them. And, you know, I have always told people that my fascination of working with urban villages in Shenzhen wasn't that I wanted to make more urban villages, of course, is I wanted to learn from the urban villages so we can fix our city planning and our urban design, our architecture, which cost the city to be unaffordable in the first place, which then led to other ways for people, individual and communities, organizations to come up with these housing informally. So, you know, that is exactly the same issue in Hong Kong. If anything, I think that the issue of the urban poor in Hong Kong is even less understood and less recognized by the international community. So, you know, the Shenzhen book took me 15 years. I'm hoping to be able to share something with you and on this aspect of Hong Kong over the next 10 years. or so. I'll try to be a little bit faster, but yeah, I'm very, very slow. I'm a slow learner. I'm a slow writer. So it just, what can I say? It takes me a long time. I'm getting there. I'm getting to a particular point where I think I found what I want to say about this particular city to be able to share.
Yes. No. Well, thank you. And thank you so much. And for the audience, thank you for your questions. I wish we had time to address them all, but we'll have to leave it there. I will say thank all of you for joining us. Again, the ASU Library has copies of the book available, and we encourage you to read further. This and other events are filmed and archived at the Institute for Humanity Research YouTube channel. So you can go back and watch, and you can recommend it to friends, to students and so forth, colleagues. And we hope that you'll join us for the Honorable Mention Book event with Francine Banner. Her book, Crowdsourcing the Law, Trying Sexual Assault in Social Media. That will be Thursday, October 15th. So next Thursday, October 15th at 3:30 Arizona time. And thank you again.
Thank you. And I'm sorry, I now just see on Q&A, there's other questions.
I think what we'll do is just we can try to figure through comments, the online comments on YouTube, to be able to try to address some.
No, that's fine. What I was going to say is for anyone who's still listening, and if you raise a question or if you have questions, you're also welcome to email me. Since we're not together in the same place, you can't kind of slowly walk up to the speaker's podium and say, I have a question. If there's other formats we can do this, we'll try to do it. But I want to thank you, Ron. Thanks to all your wonderful colleagues at the Institute for Humanities Research, who has made me feel so welcomed and connected. And thanks to everyone who had listened to the talk. I kind of realized that I did exactly what not to do for give book talks. I prepared my presentation, and then I kind of looked around, read around to say like what not to do. And it says, do not go through your book. Don't speak about your book, speak of yourself. And I thought, you know what? I can't do that. I'm going to speak about the book. So thank you for your patience. And I hope it was not entirely boring, and that you have found it to be worth your time.
Thank you all. Good evening.
Bye-bye.